The Bacchae, by Euripides, is a story of godly revenge. Pentheus, the new king of Thebes, does not allow anyone to worship Dionysus, the god of wine and merriment. Dionysus seeks vengeance by sending all of the women in Thebes into a dancing frenzy on neighboring Mount Kithaeron. In this scene, Dionysus, disguised as a foreigner who worships the god, is questioned by the king Pentheus, who has no idea he's talking to Dionysus himself.
To women, of course, that's why I came to Thebes. This long hair of yours, you're no wrestler, are you? These curves along your cheek, oh, they'll swoon for you. And this fine complexion, you have to work on that. Seeing out the sun, in the shadows, hunting for your pretty face, your sex, Aphrodite's business. So tell me this first, where are you from?
Right away, sir. It's a simple story. No doubt you've heard of Mount Tumnus, where flowers grow?
I have. Runs around the city of Sardis, circles it.
That is where I'm from. Lydia is my country.
What was your reason for bringing this cult religion to Greece?
Dionysus made the initiate himself. He's the son of Zeus.
What do you have there? Some Zeus who spawns new gods?
No, it was here that he joined Semele in marriage.
Did he take you by force in a dream, or did you see him?
Face to face, and he personally taught me the rituals.
Tell me about these rituals. What do they look like?
They may not be revealed to those who are not Bacchants.
What's the good of these rituals to people who celebrate them?
Hearing that is forbidden to you, but knowing it would be of value.
What a neat quibble. Now I really want to hear.
Keep up that irreverence and the dance will turn hostile.
You say you saw the god clearly. What did he look like?
Whatever he wanted, I had no control over that.
Another clever diversion! You didn't say a thing!
Speak wisdom to a fool and he'll think you have no sense at all.
To whom else have you brought this divinity of yours?
Outside Greece, everyone is already dancing for him.
That's because foreigners have so little sense compared to us.
More. Much more. They just have different customs.
You have to be punished for this wicked cleverness!
And you for stupidity, for a reverence to the god.
Tough talk for a Bacchant. You get lots of exercise. With words.
What penalty do you propose? What horrible thing will you do?
First, we'll shear off your pretty Goldilocks.
That's sacred. I grow my hair in honor of the god.
And next, hand over your Thyrsus.
Take it away yourself. The one I carry belongs to Dionysus.
And we'll lock you up and keep you under guard.
The god will set me free whenever I want.
Sure he will. Whenever you are among the Bacchae and summon him.
Even now he is near and sees when I'm suffering.
Then where is he? He has not yet revealed himself to me.
He is where I am. And he sees what I'm suffering. You do not see him because you lack reverence.
Grab him! He has insulted me and Thebes!
I proclaim, do not tie me. Believe me, I am sane and you are crazy.
Believe me, tie him up. I have you in my power.
How do you live? What are you doing? Who are you? You don't know.
I am Pentheus, son of Agave. My father was a Chion.
Misfortune becomes you with a name like that.
Get out! Lock him up in the horse stalls and let him stare at gloom and darkness. There's a place for you to dance.
After the last scene, Dionysus convinces Pentheus to go watch the woman, also known as Bacchants or Maenads, dancing on the mountain. When Pentheus gets there, Dionysus orders the woman, including Pentheus' mother, Agave, to kill him. They tear him limb from limb. In this scene, Agave returns to Thebes, unaware that she has murdered her son, and sees her father, Cadmus.
Bacchae from Asia! What are you shouting about?
We're bringing it home from the mountains, a fresh cut, curling shoot of the vine.
so join me in the face.
What beast? Join you in misery?
He is young. The young bull does just begin to grow curls down his cheeks, and the hair on his head is soft.
His hair, at least, would soothe a beast from the countryside.
And Bacchus, dog-driving hunter, was cunning. Cunningly he roused Maenads against his beast.
The Lord is a hunter!
You praise?
I praise!
This way! That horrible thing you carry is Pentheus. This way, in front of the house. It took me endless trouble to find the body in the ravine down and bring it here, all torn apart, no two pieces in the same place. It was very hard to find them in the woods. I didn't hear from anyone what my daughters had done, the reckless maniacs, so I was back in the city after coming down from the Bacchic dance with old Tiresias. So I hurried back to the mountain, and here I am, bringing the boy who was killed by maniacs. I saw a tunnel way up there. That was Actaeon's mother, and Ino, too. Still afflicted, raving in oak thickets, bitten with frenzy. But Agave, someone said, she danced her way down here in the Bacchic style. And it's quite true what I heard. I am looking at her now, and what a miserable sight she is.
Father, no man can brag about his daughters more than you. We are the best daughters a man could have, by far, all of us, but me especially. I gave up weaving, left my shuttles at the loom, and took on more important work, big game hunting. And I brought you this. It is, do you see? It is my trophy that I bring you to hang on your house. Take it, Father, put out your hands. Hang it on your house for all to see. Announce a banquet, you are blessed, blessed. We have achieved such things.
Grief beyond measure, I can't take it in. Achieved, wretched hands, it's murder. A fine victim for a sacrifice. You strike him down from the gods and invite all thieves and meats to the feast. Oh, I grieve more for your disaster than for mine. The god had a right to distress, Lord of Thunder, but he went too far, considering he was born in our family.
Well, you're hard to please. It's old age for you. Always with a scowl in a man's eye. But my son Pentheus, he should learn from this and be a lucky hunter when he goes out to hunt game with the boys from Thebes.
When you know what you've done, you'll feel the most terrible agony and pain. But if you stay in the state you're in forever, you'll be unlucky to the end and never have the faintest idea.
What do you mean? It's not beautiful? It's painful?
First, let your eyes look at the sky, up here.
I'm looking. Why did you suggest I do this, Father?
Is it the same, or do you think it changes?
It's brighter now, a new glow shines through it.
And that fluttering sensation, still of that in your soul?
I'm not sure what you were talking about, but I'm somehow coming back into my right mind and moving from the old thoughts.
Can you listen now and answer clearly?
I'm not sure what we were talking about, Father.
When you married, what house did you go to?
You gave me to Achaeon, a son man, so they said.
And who was the son born at home to your husband?
Pentheus, from my marriage to his father.
Tell me now. Whose face do you have in your arms?
A lion cub's, or that's what they said, the hunters.
Look straight this time. It won't take long to see it.
Ah! What is it I have in my hand?
Look clearly, and you will learn the answer.
I'm in so much pain. I'm miserable.
You don't think it looks like a lion anymore?
No, it is Pentheus's head that I carry.
Be mourned for him before you even knew who he was.
How did he die? Who killed him?
Truth is horrible. It always comes at the wrong time.
Please, tell me, Father. My heart is pounding.
You killed him. You and your sisters.
What kind of place? Where did he die?
The place where, before this, dogs tore Actaeon apart.
But why was he at Kithaeron? Were the gods against him?
He went to Jareth, god, and at your Bacchic dances, too.
And us? How did we come to get up there?
You were mad. The whole city had gone into Bacchic frenzy.
I see. Dionysus destroyed us. I understand.
He was insulted outrageously when you did not believe he was a god.
My son's body, the
William Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream tells the story of magical fairies, mixed-up lovers, and rude mechanicals putting on a play. In this first scene, Oberon and Titania, king and queen of the fairies, are feuding over the custody of a human boy.
Met by moonlight, proud Titania.
What jealous Oberon? Fairies, skip his! I have forsworn his bed and company.
Tarry, rash wanton, am not I thy lord?
Then I must be thy lady. But I know when thou hast stolen away from Fairyland, and in the shape of Corin sat all day, playing pipes of corn and versing the love to amorous Philida. But why art thou here? Come from the farthest steep of India. But forsooth, the bouncing Amazon, your busty mistress and warrior love, to Theseus must be wedded, and you come to bring their bed joy and prosperity.
How canst thou thus for shame, Titania, glance at my credit with the potter, knowing I know thy love for Theseus?
It's a forgery of jealousy, and never since the middle summer spring met we on hill, in dale, forest, or mead, by paved fountain or rushy brook, or in the beechen margin of the sea, our ringlets to dance to the whistling wind. But with thy brawls thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore, the winds, piping to us in vain as in revenge, have sucked up from the sea contagious salts, which, fallen in the land, have made every pelting river so proud that they have overborne their continents. The ox, therefore, hath stretched his yoke in vain, the plowman lost his sweat, and the green corn hath rotted ere his youth attained a beard. The fold stands empty in the drowned field. The crows grow fatted with the murrain flood. The Nightman Morris is filled with mud. And the quaint mazes in the wanton green for lack of tread are undistinguishable. But from these same progeny of evils comes our debate, our dissension. We are their parents and original.
Do you amend it then? It lies in you. Why should Titania cross her Oberon? I do but beg a little changing boy to be my henchman.
Set your heart at rest. The fairyland buys not the child of me. His mother was a votress of my order, and in the spice of Indian air by night, full often hath she gossiped by my side and sat with me on Neptune's yellow sand. But being mortal of that boy did die, and it is for her sake
sake that I do rear up her boy, and for her sake that I will never part with him.
How long within this wood intend you stay?
Perhaps to Theseus' wedding day, but if thy will patiently go in our round and dance in our moonlight revels, then go with us. But if not, then shun me, and I will spare thy haunts.
Give me that boy, and I will go with thee.
Not for thy fairyland. Fairies away! We shall try it downright if I longer stay.
Well, go thy way. Thou shalt not from this grove till I torment thee for this injury.
Hermia, Helena, Lysander, and Demetrius are a walking love triangle, or rather, a love quadrangle. At the beginning of the play, Hermia and Lysander are in love, but Hermia's father has decreed that Demetrius to marry her. To complicate matters, Helena is madly in love with Demetrius, who can't stand her. However, in the forest, Puck has put a spell on both Demetrius and Lysander, which has caused them both to fall in love with Helena, who is very confused and believes they are mocking her.
Why should you think I should mourn scorn? Scorn and derision never come in tears. Look, when I bow and weep and bow so born, in their nativity all truth appears. How can these things in me seem scorn to you, bearing the badge of faith that proven true?
You do advance your cunning more and more, kill truth with truth, O devilish holy fray. These vows are Hermia's. We give her o'er, we oath with oath, and you will nothing weigh. Your vows to her and me, put in two scales, will even weigh both light as tails.
I had no judgment when to her I swore.
Well, not in my mind, now you give her o'er.
Demetrius loves her, and he loves not you.
Oh, Helena, goddess, nymph, perfect wine. To what shall I compare thy eye? Crystal is muddy, oh, how ripe and show. Thy lips, those kissing cherries,
oh, smites, oh, pal! I see you all are bent to set against me for your merriment. Do you not hate me, as I know you do, but must join in souls to mock me too?
You are unkind, Demetrius. Be not so, for you love Hermia. This you know I know.
Lysander, keep thy Hermia. I want none. If e'er I loved her, all that love is gone.
Helen, it is not so.
Disparage not the faith thou dost not know, lest to thy peril abide thee. Look, well thy love comes. Yonder is thy dear.
Why so unkindly didst thou leave me so?
Why should he stay, whom love doth press to go?
What love can press Lysander from my side?
Lysander's love, that would not let him bide. Fair Helen, more in gills the night than all you fire-o's and eyes of light. Why seekest thou me?
Could not this make me know? The hate I bear thee make me be so?
You speak not as you think. It cannot be.
No, she is one of this confederacy. I perceive they have conjoined all three to fashion this false sport. In spite of me, injurious Hermia, oh, is all forgot, and will you rend our ancient love asunder to join with men in scorning your poor friends?
I'm amazed at your passionate words. I scorn you not. It seems that you scorn me.
Have you not, silly Sander, as in scorn, to follow me and praise my eyes and face, and meet your other love, Demetrius, who even but now then spurned with his foot to call me goddess, nymph, divine and rare, precious, celestial.
I understand not what you mean by this.
If you had any pity, grace, or manners, you would not make me such an argument. But fare ye well. 'Tis partly my fault, which death or absence soon shall remedy.
Stay, gentle Helena. Hear my excuse. Helen, I love thee, by my life I do. I swear by which I will lose for thee to prove him false that says I love thee not.
I say I love thee more than he can do.
If thou say so, withdraw and prove it.
Quick, come.
Lysander, where to attend all this?
Hang up, thou cat, thou fur, vile thing. Let loose, or I will shake thee from me like a serpent.
Am not I, Hermia? Am not you, Lysander? I am as fair now as I was erewhile. Since night you loved me, yet since night you left me. Why then you left me? Oh, the gods forbid, in earnest shall I say.
I, by my life, and never did desire to see thee more.
Oh, me. You juggler, you canker blossom, you thief of love. What, have you come by night and stolen my love's heart from him?
Have you no modesty, no maiden shame, no touch of bashfulness? What, will you tear impatient answers from my gentle tongue? Bye, bye, you counterfeit, you puppet, you!
Puppet? Why so? Aye, that way goes the game. Now I perceive that she hath made compare between our statures. She hath urged her height, and with her personage, her tall personage, her height pursuits, she hath prevailed with him. And now, how low am I? lie, you painted maypole. Speak, how low am I? Not yet so low that my nails can reach into thine eyes.
I pray, even though you mock me, gentlemen, let her not hurt me. I was never cursed. Let her not strike me. You perhaps may believe that because she is something lower than myself, that I can match her.
Lower? Hark again.
Good, Hermia. Do not be so bitter with me. I have more to love you, Hermia. And now, so you will let me quiet go to Athens, where I bear my folly back and follow you no more. Let me go.
My pity gone. Who is it that hinders you?
A foolish heart that leave here behind.
What? With Lysander?
With Demetrius.
Be not afraid. She shall not harm thee, Helen.
No, so she shall not, though you take her part.
Oh, when she is angry, she is keen and shrewd. She was a vixen when she went to school, and though she be but little, she is fierce.
Little? Nothing but low and little. Why must you suffer her thus? And let me come to her.
Get gone, you dwarf. Now follow, if thou darest, to try whose right of thine or mine is most.
Follow me. I'll go with thee cheek by Jove.
I no longer trust you. I will no longer stay in your cursed company. Your hands and mine are quicker for a fray. My legs are longer, though, to run away!
For our final selection from Midsummer, we present A Play Within a Play. A troop of bumbling workmen have decided to put on a play in honor of Duke Theseus on his wedding day. In this scene, they perform Pyramus and Thisbe, but just remember, they aren't exactly professional actors.
Show, but wonder on, till truth make all things plain. This man is Pyramus, if you would know. This beauteous lady, Thisbe, is certain. This man, with lime and rough cast, doth present Wall, that vile wall with which these lovers sunder. And through Wall's chink, they are content to whisper, at which let no man wonder. This man with lanthorn, dog, and bush of thorn, presenteth moonshine, for if you will know, by moonshine did these lovers think no scorn, to meet at Ninus tomb, and there to rue. And this grisly beast, which lion hight by name, this trusty Thisbe coming first by night, did scare away, or rather did affright. And as she bled, her mantle she did fall, and lion vile with bloody mouth did stain. Anon comes Pyramus, sweet youth and tall, and finding trusty Thisbe's mantle slain, with bloody blameful blade, he bravely broached his bloody boiling breast. And Thisbe, tarrying in mulberry shade, his dagger drew and died. The lion, moonshine, wall, and lovers twain
at large discourse, while here they do remain.
In this same interlude, it doth befall that I, one snout, by name, present a wall. And such a wall as I would have you think that had in it a crannied hole or chink, through which the lovers, Pyramus and Thisbe, did whisper often very secretly. And this the cranny is right and sinister, through which the fearful lovers are to whisper.
'Tis the wittiest partition that ever I heard discourse, my lord.
Pyramus approaches the wall. Silence.
Oh, grim-looked night, oh, night with you so black, oh, night which ever art when day is not, oh, night, alack, alack, alack. I fear my Thisbe's promise is forgot. And thou, oh, wall, oh, sweet, oh, lovely wall, that stands between her father's ground and mine, oh, wall, thou, wall, oh, sweet and lovely wall, show me a chink to blink through with mine eye. Thanks, courteous wall. Jove shield thee well for this. But what see I? No Thisbe do I see. Oh, wicked wall, through whom I see no bliss, cursed be thy stones for thus deceiving me.
The wall, methinks, being sensible, should curse again.
No, in truth, sir, he should not. Deceiving me is Thisbe's cue. She is to enter now, and I will spy her through the chink.
You shall see. It will fall pat as I told you. Yonder she comes.
Oh, whoa! Not to pass the hard my bones for parting my bad penis. My cherry lips have often kissed thy stones with lime and tang topping thee.
I see a voice. Now will I to the chink to spy, and I can hear my Thisbe's face. Thisbe?
My love, thou art, but my thing.
Think what thou wilt, I am thy lover's grace, and like Lymander I am trusting still.
And I like Helen till the fates me kill.
Oh, kiss me through the hole of this vile ball.
I kissed the wall's hole, not your lips at all.
Wilt thou meet me at Ninny's tomb?
Ninus!
Ninus' tomb, straightway.
Tide life, tide death, I come without delay.
Thus have I, wall, my part discharged so, and being done, thus away this wall hath come.
You ladies, you whose gentle hearts do fear the smallest monstrous mouse that creeps on the floor, may now perchance both quake and tremble here when lion rough and wildest rage doth roar, to know that I, one, Snug the joiner, am a lion fell, nor no lion's dam. For in this place, as if I should, as lion, come in strife, into this place, for pity on me.
A very gentle beast, of a good conscience.
This Lanthorn doth the horned moon present.
He shall have worn the horns on his head. He is no crescent, and the horns are invisible within the circumference.
This Lanthorn doth the horned moon present. Myself, the man in the moon, do seem to be.
This is the greatest error of them all. The man should be put into the Lanthorn. How else is it the man in the moon?
Proceed, moon. All that I have to say is to tell you that this Lanthorn is the moon. I, the man, is the moon. This thorn bush, my thorn bush, and this dog, my dog.
All of these should be in the Lanthorn, for all of these are in the moon.
And then came Thisbe.
This is old Ninny's tomb.
Ninus!
Ninus' tomb. Where is my love?
Sweet moon, I thank thee for thy sunny beams.
Moonshine.
I thank thee, moon, for shining now so bright.
Moonshine.
For by thy gracious golden glittering gleams.
Moonshine.
I trust the peg of truth this be sight.
Moonshine.
But stay, O spite, but mark, poor knight, what dreadful dole is here. Eyes, do you see? How can it be? O dainty duck, O dear. Thy mantle good, what stained with blood? Oh, wherefore, nature, didst thou lion's frame? Since lion vile hath here deflowered, my dear. Come, tears confound. Out, sword and wound, the pap of Pyramus. I, that left pap where heart doth hop. Thus die I. Thus, thus, thus. Now am I dead. Now am I fled. My soul is in the sky. Come, loose thy light. Moon, take thy flight.
Moonshine.
Now die, 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 die.
Is gone before Thisbe comes back and finds her lover.
She will find him by starlight. Here she comes, and her passion ends the play.
Methinks you should not use a long one for such a Pyramus. I hope she will be brief.
Asleep, my love? What, dead, my love? Oh, Pyramus, arise. Speak, quite dumb. Dead? Dead? A tomb must cover thy sweet eyes. These red lips, this cherry nose, these yellow cowslip cheeks are gone, are gone. Lovers made more. Oh, sisters three, come, come to me. With hands as pale as milk, living and gone. Since you have shore, since you have shore, with his threads of silk, tongue, not a word. Come, trusty sword, come play my best in brew. Farewell, friend. Thus this be ends. Adieu, adieu, adieu.
Assure you, Wall is down that part of their fathers. Will it please you to see an epilogue?
No epilogue, I pray you. This play needs no excuse. Never excuse. For when all the players are dead, there is none to be blamed.
Hey, Caleb. I heard it's Trisha's birthday today. What are you gonna do?
Well, you see, she really loves all the pranks on AFV, America's Funniest Videos. So I have a few of my own that I'm sure she's gonna love too.
Cool, dude. See you in English.
It's your birthday.
Aren't you going to give me a present?
Well, of course.
Ew, that's what smelled bad.
They smell beautiful.
But it was part of the prank. They were supposed to smell bad. I'll try better next time.
You gave me stinky flowers? Wait, prank? No more pranks, please.
Trisha's going to love this one. Nothing. I was just stretching.
Oh, well,
Somebody hurt Becca? Oh no, not my baby Becca. She was all alone in the parking lot.
Haha, already posted.
What are you talking about? This is no time for social media.
Should have seen your face. You got pranked.
Wait, you're pranking me? So does this mean we're getting back together?
No. That was just payback.
Hey. meanwhile...
No! This isn't right.
Today for my chemistry final, I'll be presenting on the various chemicals that affect human emotion. First off, we have dopamine, which is C8H11NO2. Dopamine, when released, causes a feeling of happiness. Next off, we have serotonin, which is C10H12N2O. Serotonin greatly affects like how calm and relaxed a person is. Next off, we have norepinephrine, C8H11NO3. This causes the well-known fight or flight reaction to a threatening situation. And lastly, phenethylamine, C8H11N, the magical love hormone. What a wonderful thing love is. I mean, the crush, first date, the falling head over heels. I can't believe I'm about to say this, but Dakota, I think I love you. And while I'm at it, I guess I might as well give you some good reasons as to why I'd be a wonderful boyfriend. First of all, I'm really familiar with the chemistry textbook, so if you ever need a study buddy, I'm your guy. Also, I have the complete works of James Clerk Maxwell, a famous Victorian scientist poet, committed to memory. To quote one of his poems, which is entitled, "Lines written under the conviction that it is not wise to read mathematics in November after one's fire cell." The quote goes as follows. Truth should spring from stale ground, beauty beam from all around, right should then at last be found, joining what none may sever. If I can remember all of that, I'm never gonna forget a birthday or our anniversary. I don't know. I guess what I'm trying to say is I know that you're the cheer captain and I know that I'm the captain of the chess club, but I don't think that should matter. You have a wonderful face, wonderful hair, and a wonderful personality, and I really think that we could become something lasting. So, what do you say?
I gotta go.
ZYXWVUTSRQPONMLKJIHGFEDCBA. Take that, you bloody muppet.
Well, are you gonna tell me or what?
Well, that's another question.
Do you like anyone else?
No.
Really? Come on, just tell. I promise I won't tell anyone.
I said I didn't like anyone.
I know when you're lying to me, Elle. Just tell. It's like not that big of a deal.
Mara, stop. I said I didn't like anyone.
Ella, just tell me.
I said I didn't like anyone.
Just tell me.
It's Finn. Guy, who are you? Happy now?
Seriously? Do you honestly think I'm happy right now? My best friend.
Oh, so now we're best friends.
It's not gonna. No, you liked him in the first place.
You didn't even ask.
Well, it's not like we've been hanging out lately.
Or talking, or even acknowledging each other's existence. I mean, we haven't spoken to each other in weeks. And lunch, nothing. All you've been doing is hanging out with Finn. All I wanted to do was talk to you, and this sleepover was supposed to happen like a month ago.
Wow, Ella, I'm really sorry, but it's Finn we're talking about. If I get with him, maybe I'll finally be popular.
Is popularity worth our friendship? You're willing to throw away this for a guy in popularity?
I just want to finally fit in, Ella.
You do fit in. This, us, Morella, best friends forever, right?
Right. Gosh, I'm so sorry. Ella, I can't believe I made you feel so horrible.
Aww.
Besides, Finn isn't worth our friendship. I mean, he's really, really, really attractive, but the rest of him is horrible.
I mean, he doesn't even say thank you in the lunch line. How dare he?
Rude much?
Yeah. Disgusting. Who is it?
It's Finn.
Yeah.
He just Snapchatted me, and he wants to see if I want to go on a date with him Friday.
What are you going to tell him?
Never in a million years, Finn. I already have plans. Sent and done.
Wait, you have plans?
Yeah, with you, silly.
Oh.
No.
Sandra. My name is Jonathan, and I... it's too pathetic.
Well, can you please hurry up? I have class in 3 minutes. You were wondering about something?
I was wondering if you'd like to go to prom with me.
Oh. Well, that's really kind of you.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, your answer?
I mean, it must have taken so much courage to walk over to here and talk to me.
Of course, but your answer?
Look, I think that...
Wait, I have a better way to ask you out.
Yeah, what is it?
Sandra, as my way of asking you to be my date to this year's prom, I'd like to present you with this poem I wrote. Oh, Sandra, I have known you for quite some time, and I just wanted to tell it thee that I am really admiring you from afar, and I would like to tell you that I have forsworn asking any other female to the dance, and you if are very pretty. Oh, Sandra, please have come to prom. I would like it to see your gregarious feet dancing on the floor with mine. I know thee is a Wonderland dancer, as I have seen thee dot dancing in her bedroom. Oh, Sandra, please come to the dance with me.
What? Does he spy on me? Has he even read Shakespeare? That's a horrible poem.
So, what'd you think? Of the poem, of course. I already know you're in love with me now.
Great.
Oh, yeah, really? That's amazing. Everybody told me it was horrible.
They must have been in their right mind.
But it's amazing that you actually like it.
Yep, great. So, well, I have to go now.
Wait, I have one last way to ask you to the prom.
I'm sure you do.
And after this, I'm sure you're gonna say yes. Ready, guys?
Five, six, seven, eight.
Just keep your eyes on me. I said you're holding back. She said,
an eight.
What is love? Baby, don't hurt me.
What is love?